sign coming out tonight. As someone has rightly pointed out to me, it is quite important night for Champions League football. But hey, you need to win, okay? We've got Hustings. First of all, I'd like to introduce candidates on the table. So what I will do in the first instance is pass the microphone to each candidate and then explain, should say, the rules of engagement. Please.
I hope you don't hold it against me, but I'm not interested in the football tonight because I'm a Leeds supporter. I'm Councillor Jack Cohen and I've been representing this ward since 1986.
Coming from Manchester and being a Manchester United supporter, this evening's match has a particular poignancy. Never clear whether Liverpool or Manchester City was the real opposition. I'm Councillor Peter Zinkin. I've been the councillor for nearly 4 years representing the Conservative Party.
Hello, my name is Nigel Young. I'm the candidate for one of the candidates for the Labour Party.
Hi, my name is Obi. Unfortunately, Gemma Ferguson couldn't turn up tonight because she's on holiday with her mother. It was a bit late. So my name is Obi Raymond Obedensha. I'm actually standing for the Green Party in Totteridge. So, thank you. Oh, and my sport is actually a screamer, it's not football. Sorry.
Okay, well, thank you all. Now, tonight will be quite interesting, simply because we're going to offer each of the candidates at the get-go the opportunity, 5 minutes, to introduce themselves. Each candidate will have that opportunity, after which questions will be open to the floor. Now, we're going to suggest that each response is no longer than 2 minutes. I think with 4 candidates that we should get through a fair amount of questions. If anyone feels differently, we are quite flexible, so speak now or for a little piece.
2 minutes?
Yeah. Okay. So if we start at the end of the table with Obi, as you know, he's here tonight representing his colleague who's not around tonight, but I'm sure they. Who knows what the manifesto is about. So, over to the Green Party.
Bye.
5 minutes. Okay, sorry. Apologies. Okay, so my name is Obi. Raymond Adventure, but most people call me as Obi. I came to the Green Party as an activist, mainly environmental and also social, mainly housing. I've been involved in a number of struggles and fights to save housing for the people of London, from Aylesbury, Highgate, Embarno would be Dulles Valley, our West Hendon, Sweet's Way, and yes, my friends in the Green Party in Barnet are involved in the same fight as well. So we do talk about what's happening, unfortunately, in Barnet and other boroughs in London. So it's sort of, it's the same thing all the time. They want to get rid of the people in, because your estate's probably more valuable to property developers without you in them. So they would actually try to compulsory purchase orders, just check out West Hendon for one or Sweet's Way, and you can see what they're doing to the people in those estates. Sweet's Way is actually the worst one because it was a housing association, but then for some reason, the council decided to give planning permission for terra firma to basically destroy a community and then turn it into million-pound houses. And the same thing will probably happen with Charles Hill because it is actually prime development land. I don't know yet how much Charles Hill is worth, Granville Estate is worth to the property developers. But put it this way, Aylesbury Estate was sold for £40 million by the Southwark Labour Council. It actually cost £60 million to get rid of the people, to decant them to outside London, and it's now worth £1.5 billion. And from what I gather, Dawes Valley is now different. It's named differently now. It's also a £1 billion development, and we don't even know how much. And West Hendon was sold to Barrett's for £3. So that's what you face. Housing estate that was that people had spent decades, generations, to build a community, and then it just got sold to Barrett's for £3. It's disgusting, but unfortunately, it keeps happening to people, and the only way you can do this is keep fighting it. So, as a member of the Green Party, that's what we do. We this sort of stigma, as we're just talking about the environment all the time. Unfortunately, we also need people to protect the environment, and the only way you can do that should be for you to have your own homes. And the same thing with properly insulated homes, properly, and actually I'm walking 5 minutes too long for me. yeah, so any questions would actually be, would probably be better for me anyway, so I'll give the next guy. Thank you.
Good evening. As you know, I'm Nigel Young.
Is that okay? Yeah.
Thank you, Anthony, and thank you to Granville Road Residents Association for inviting us here tonight. Thank you all for coming out, and I'm looking forward to hearing what I know will be some challenging questions. I'm Nigel Young, one of three candidates, Labour candidates, here with Anne Clark. And together with Anne Clark and Lisa Pate, we will bring a wide range of skills and experience to the role of councillors. Anne is Joint Chair of Governors at Hampstead School and Vice Chair of Governors at All Saints School. She also chairs the Groves Residents Association and sits on the Cricklewood Town team, while Lisa is a Governor at St Agnes and a long-term campaigner to Dundonaghue. They have both played leading roles in campaigns on saving our libraries, school funding, early years education and saving our green spaces. Indeed, it was Anne who made the successful application to protect the green space outside B&Q. For my part, I have 30 years' experience in regeneration, planning and community engagement, which I will put to use in Charlesfield to ensure that future development schemes put the community first. Indeed, having listened to your concerns about the lack of sprinklers after the AGM here, I have secured a commitment that a future Labour Council would install sprinklers in the tower blocks. As a team, we've supported the community in its fight against Donoghue's and the aggregates site. We've all experience of bringing up families in the area, and myself for caring for a disabled relative here in Barnet, so we know what it's like trying to access local services. We are therefore on your side, and we are committed to listening to your concerns and aspirations. As councillors, we will hold surgeries in Charles Hill every week, so it will be easy to come and see us face to face as well as the usual methods. Here on the Granville Road, you've told us about the loss of your community centre, your flats being cold and damp because of delays in replacing the cladding to the towers, boilers breaking down, the need for sprinklers and better alarms. We also understand your anger at the redevelopment of the estate, where the Tory deal resulted in the loss of your green spaces and paths and the loss of your storage, and will put increased pressure on parking, not to mention overstretched local services. And of course, social care here, the children's services have been rated as inadequate. And despite your concerns about the lack of affordable housing, the redevelopment would result in the loss of the existing social rent and affordable housing. But we shouldn't be surprised, because across the borough, the Tory Council has lost 800 council homes in redevelopment plans. We see this disregard across Barnet. In Cricklewood, the council's proposal for an 11-acre site for open storage of waste and aggregates has been approved, despite 800 objections, bringing misery to an area already suffering from the failure of the council to take robust action against dust, noise and lorry traffic on the Donoghue site. Not only does this council not listen, but they have also lost millions of pounds in banned land deals, as we just heard, and have risked millions on advance payments to capital. And while illegally hiking up parking permit charges, Tory councillors have awarded themselves borough-wide parking permits. But even more serious are the massive cuts to police budgets under the Conservative and Lib Dem coalition government, and more recently. resulting in the loss of 332 officers from the police here in Barnet. Meanwhile, the Tory leader of the council said that our proposals for extra police were not worth the money. Well, we would rather listen to you, and tackling crime and antisocial behaviour is one of your top priorities. So we have set a set of six priorities for this area. Firstly, a commitment to put local residents first, giving you more opportunities to engage with the council and freezing council tax this year. Secondly, cracking down on crime and antisocial behaviour, making our streets safer with 30 new police officers in a safer Barnet police team. Thirdly, building more genuinely affordable homes, and we will build at least 800 new council homes and crack down on rogue landlords. Our fourth pledge is to support our local community, our local economy, and introduce 30 minutes free parking in high street shopping areas. And our fifth pledge is to protect the environment, improve the quality of our roads, increase recycling rates, take tough action on fly tipping, and provide a free bulky item collection for householders. And finally, we will support families and we will ensure our children's services return to good. In conclusion, we have an experienced and committed team here in Charles Hill. We will be different. We have put you first. We will prioritise the things you care about, protect the things you value, and spend your money wisely. It's time for a change here. It's time for a Labour Council.
I'd like to start by thanking Anthony and the GERA team for putting on these hustings. Over the last 4 years, Councillor Ryde and I have got to know Anthony and some of the GERA team, and we really value the relationship, but actually I think all of you need to value much more the work that Anthony does for this community, and as we're going to discuss over the next few minutes, it is very, very extensive. So I think we should say thank you to him, please. It's a privilege to continue to work with him. As I said at the beginning, I'm Councillor Peter Zinkin. I have my colleague, Councillor Shimon Ryde, with me. Many of you, I hope, have come across. Our third candidate is Dr. Vanessa Ryde, who lives in Hampstead Garden suburb but is a governor at Wessex Gardens. I live in the ward. my colleague lives in Gilvers Green. I thought that the best thing to do was to talk about our involvement with this community, Grand Road area, over the last 4 years, to give you a sense of what we've done in this area. And it really started with the development. One of the first things that I did after we got elected was ask officers if I could see the development agreement to actually try and find out whether there was any chance of stopping the development or reducing the development. Officers actually refused to let me see it, as a result of which, having raised this to the highest level in the council, we actually changed the constitution to make it clear that we could get access to such documents. We then did study the development agreement in great detail to see if there were any areas at all where we could put pressure on the developer. We found one or two, and we did. We spoke at the planning committee. Councillor Ryde spoke passionately against the development. We also worked very hard on our colleagues to try and explain to them why this was overdevelopment. The loss of green space was terrible. And uniquely, I think, we actually, between us all, persuaded the planning committee to turn down the development because it was too much and the loss of green space was too great. We went to the appeal, we spoke at the appeal, you all spoke at the appeal, and unfortunately the inspector concluded in the end that actually, given the need for housing, that he was going to allow the development. Since then, we have been working to try and get the developer to communicate properly with you. We asked officers to set up with a meeting with the developer so we could make it absolutely clear the distress and rage of the community about the development and the need for decent communication, because their first effort was quite frankly both incorrect and pathetic. Since then, of course, there is a number of problems. There's the compulsory purchase order for the pram shed. And we still think over the next period there may be opportunities to reduce the scale of development. And please be assured that if we're re-elected, we will work very hard to make that happen, because we understand the issue. From the very beginning, my colleague was absolutely clear that this was too much for this area. Then, of course, there is the cladding after the terrible Grenfell fire. We are actually much happier to be guided by residents about sprinklers, because our reading of the meeting that we came to when this was all discussed was that there were arguments for and against sprinklers, but at the end of time, we were being guided entirely by residents once they understand the implications of having separate sprinkler systems in every flat. There were the energy payments, because as you all know, that once the cladding was removed, energy bills went up very substantially. There were problems with the way the council was making those energy payments. Anthony explained to us the difficulties that people had. We spoke to officers and we got that all changed so that people got the payments directly. We pressured officers to get on with this. There is a current planning application for the new solid aluminium, which is the absolute best fire-rated cladding which is available. And I think that although it was very unfortunate that the only three tower blocks that in the whole of Barnet that had this cladding were the three on this estate and in our ward, the actions that the housing people took to put fire wardens here, to put people here, to organise the removal of the cladding was really extremely good. And that's just a few of the things. There's the community centre that we've worked on, there's the Wheelio scheme that we've worked on and helped Anthony with, there was the bid for the library that we helped Anthony and Mo with, there's the work we've done on Nant Court, and the other grants that we have got in the area. There are many other issues that we've been involved in the area. I've personally brought three or four senior council officers down here to the estate to walk over it so that they know the estate and know what the issues are. And we'll be very happy to talk about these and many of the points that have been raised already in the questions that we're sure you're going to ask. Thank you very much.
GERA for organising the Hustings and inviting in the other candidates. Of course, thank you all for turning up. You know, up to a few months ago, some people in the other two parties were going around telling everybody I wasn't going to stand. Well, here I am, I'm nominated, and I'm standing. And do you know what? Do you know why I'm standing? Because I'm so frustrated and angry about what's happened to the Borough of Barnet under the Conservative administration. And as long as I feel I can be angry, I'm prepared to stand and, if re-elected, work as hard as I ever have on your behalf. And it's great to be standing with, I call Lady Suzette Palmer, his official title, but Suzette wants to call Suzette. And the third candidate is Sachin Patel, who can't be with us tonight, but Sachin tells me he wasn't born when I was first elected. So think about that. And why it's great to have my two colleagues, especially Suzette, is because it reminds me of what we achieved when we had three Liberal Democrat councillors representing this ward. Yeah. And let me tell you something. The other two parties will go around telling you, don't vote Liberal Democrat in this ward, because Labour will say, let the Tories in, and the Tories will say, let Labour in. Wrong. If you vote Liberal Democrat, you'll get three Liberal Democrat councillors. And I've been working on my own, and I've achieved quite a bit. But think what three of us can do. And Suzette reminds me that when we were in administration with the Labour Party, Suzette was in charge of libraries. And we won beacon status for our libraries. And look what's happened to our libraries now. When we had the same things, the public, you, were really listened to. You could come and speak at planning committee, not for 2 or 3 minutes, but for 5 minutes. So you had a real chance to get across your message. Do you remember the residence forums we used to have? Packed out, standing room only. Now, they've withered on the vine. The reason for this is because the Conservative Council introduced such strict rules of engagement that people got turned off and don't bother. That's not the way to run a council, in my opinion. Now, when Anthony sent me an email, he asked all the candidates to list what our priorities would be. I turned it around, I want to list and listen to what your priorities are. And I take that from the emails I get, which just doesn't affect you in this part of Charleston, but all over Charleston. I get loads of emails every day. It's about dirty our streets, about litter, potholes, speeding traffic. Those are the bread and butter issues. But there's more to running the council than mending potholes, however important that is. And I have to tell you, in my view, the Conservative Council have badly let you down. And one of the reasons is they've privatised everything. Capita run most of the services from Coventry, even areas further north. And no, out of sight, out of mind. And as a council, I found it more and more difficult to engage with officers, especially those that are working for a private company. So, you know, it's fashionable to make pledges to you, yeah? And then when you get into some power, you don't deliver. But I will make one pledge which I know is deliverable, and which underpins everything you do in the council. And that is to listen to you, to work for you, and to act for you. Get those three things right, and you'll have a council worth paying the council tax for. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you all. I'm sure we all appreciated your contributions. I think at this stage, we put questions out to the floor. Please be aware that the response will only be for 2 minutes. So I suspect in certain instances, you might not get the full answer that you want, but 2 minutes is the limit. If we can obviously give each person the chance to express themselves, even though we might not necessarily agree with what they say. Appreciate just to show that here in Charles Hill we do have a sense of etiquette and good manners. I suppose, what do? We sort of toss for the first person? Got a hand up.
Thank you for the question. Yes, we can. What we've seen over the last
few years, or 7 years or so, has been a continual cut in the number of police that are actually on the streets here. We have put forward a proposal whereby which has been costed and signed off by officers at the council, whereby we would fund 15 additional officers, and under the mayor's buy one get one free scheme, if you like, we would have 30 officers, and they would be on the streets. They would be targeting things like antisocial behaviour, fly tipping, those kinds of things, and they would be working hand in hand with neighbourhood teams and with the police, and they would also free up, of course, police time to be dealing with violent crime and you know, more complex criminal issues. So the answer to your question is simple: yes, they would be on the streets.
And who's paying for it, sir?
So we put forward an alternative budget as part of the budgeting process. So the Conservatives put forward a budget as part of the administration. We put forward an alternative, which is very short, which sets out how the police officer would be paid for. It's within, it won't be a rise in council tax or anything. It's all funded from within the existing budgets by reallocating funding from other programmes.
What we'll do, based on the fact that we've got a few people there, we'll probably give each candidate a chance to respond to that same question. Would that be of interest?
Yeah.
Okay, so I'll pass it on now to Councillor Zinkins. Sorry, it's not passed on.
This is actually a bit more complicated a question than perhaps Labour indicated. First of all, it's the Mayor of London who controls the police. So it all has to be agreed with the mayor. Secondly, the Labour budget amendment was for 1 year and didn't say what was going to happen at the end of that year and as to whether those police and whether redundancy money was going to come for those police unless the money was available for another year. But there's a much more fundamental point which we actually made in the budget debate, and that is that the Mayor of London has taken our money and given that money to other boroughs. We have the least police for the money that the mayor takes from all of you in council tax of any borough in London. If we had the same number of police in terms of the money that we give to the mayor towards the police, we wouldn't have 30 more police. We'd have something like 100 or more police. So what we're saying to the Mayor of London, who unfortunately does not like Barnet and treats Barnet very badly, is give us back the police that we've paid for, rather than taking more of your money to give to him to pay for police where we've already paid for it. So why the Labour Party want us to pay for our police twice is something that you, in perhaps subsequent questions, can ask the Labour Party again. Because quite honestly, it is completely and utterly disgraceful. Barnet, because of this, has more burglaries than almost any other London borough. The police are struggling to cope, and the mayor is giving our police to other London boroughs, and it's a Labour mayor who's doing that.
If I can now pass that over to you.
So if I could just widen the debate a little bit, because we've all been reading about the shocking murders and knifings going on in and around London. Now, so you know, I was a probation officer for 35 years and I worked in this area. And I think I know a little bit about crime and the cause of crime. And it's complex. There's no simple answer. But I'll tell you one thing. Police on the streets do deter crime. And it's quite clear we don't have enough police. Now, what is wrong is to get to a slanging match between a political party about who's right and who's spending too much money. the answer is to work together and ensure we have the police. So shouting the odds and complaining who's spending more money than the other isn't going to solve the crime. In fact, it's going to do nothing for it at all. So working together on these issues, in my view, is part of the solution.
Excuse me, sir. You talk about Barrack and everything else. Is there any way, slightly obvious now, prevention better than cure? Is there any way that we can prevent this happening on our streets today?
I think so. And the moment you stop thinking you can prevent it, you might as well go home and give up, quite frankly. Yeah? And so I said I got angry, and let me give you an example of why I got angry with this council. It's because they slashed, for example, the youth service budget. It doesn't get any publicity at all. Yeah? But that's one thing, slashing the youth service budget. Young people who need activities, it does work.
You are right, sir. But I think the main thing now is, with the kids of today, they are educated, but they're bored, and they just haven't got anything better to do in their lives.
Hi. The problem we have with the police is the fact that central government, since 2010, have actually cut police by 20,000. That's not actually the fault of Sadiq Khan or Boris Johnson, for that matter. There's a lot of police. I mean, back in 2012, I was actually in the demonstration when 30,000 police officers were marching through London, and that was the first time they've had a demonstration for 70 years, because they were saying, no, we can't keep cutting. And that's 2012, now it's 2018, it's 20,000 police have been cut. Unfortunately, it's not, you can't just say blame it on Sadiq Khan, blame it on unfortunately Conservative Council. It's because of the question, because I mean, Amber Rudd today was saying, oh yeah, she didn't read the report stating that crime might actually increase because you've cut the police so much. I mean, put it this way, like in Kensington, in London, Kensington actually has the highest number of bag snatches because of, well, they actually steal the bag itself and throw away the contents because the bag is very expensive. They can actually sell it on eBay probably. In my own neighborhood, in New Barnet, I have neighbors complaining that sometimes their change from, if they forget to lock their car, that some of the kids would just try it, open the car and take away the change. It's a good thing they don't damage the cars. It is a case that, yes, we need to have our youth in these bags. And I'm just glad that Sean Berry from the Green Party Assembly member in London has managed to get some funding for that, and then suppose the councils can apply for it. But that's one way to prevent children from just being rowdy, I suppose, but it's one good way to actually keep them out of trouble. But as for the other stuff, the murders that have been happening in London, knife crime and... Sorry about that.
Do apologize, so we couldn't afford the cordless microphones. Okay, if I might just intervene, it's really just a continuation of that question. So I think there's a brief suggestion that because we've talked about police, it seems sort of natural to then mention youth services. I think if we sort of put an open sort of question to all the candidates, I think if you all agree, to talk about what you feel you might do to improve the lot for the youth in Child's Hill, because that's what we're here for today. It's about the Child's Hill. In this case, I think I will start with Jack. Yes, Jack. We'll go back to Jack and then work this way back.
Excuse me. situated in where it's happening around south.
Okay.
And they're probably going to need funding, but I'm thinking now, like New York and other places like that, why don't they have civilian undercover cops to help the police combat the crimes?
I think
if the culprits to the police for about 100 miles down the road, they'll scarf them, right? They'll fly, they're missing a uniform, they'll scarf them. They'll go, the culprits will go. So if they have the undercover police, in certain areas that can be quite dangerous.
Okay, so can we let Jack answer the question?
I'm glad we decided to talk more about youth service because that's important. And I do remind you that year on year the youth service budget environment has been cut. It's about money because money talks and money buys things. But it's also about engaging young people. Now, with the greatest respect to everybody here, some of the younger people. There's very few young people kind of turn up at these Hustings. In fact, there's going to be a Hustings at one of the schools in north of the borough. And I was asked on behalf of the Dems to give a couple of sentences why young people should come to Hustings. And I think I said something like, take part in the cut and thrust of political debate, but more importantly, tell the politicians what you think needs to be done for you. And I don't think we talk to young people enough, do we? This is not another part of political, it's a fact of life and something we have to face. Well, politicians knock on doors. And I knocked on a door the other evening, and it was a young voter, a new young voter, so just on 18. And when I said, well, you know, would you vote for me, as you do, they said, well, I've got to ask my mother. And that's the kind of engagement us politicians are not making at the moment. So if you engage with young people, if you can listen to young people, what they want, because what we think they want is totally different. So money is important, engagement just as important, but at the end of the day, it's more than just listening to young people, it's actually doing something for them.
It's interesting, isn't it? Jack's standing because he's allowed to get angry that I'm not, apparently. I clearly haven't been a councillor long enough to have got to the angry bit. As far as youth is concerned, there are quite a lot of things actually going on in the borough for youth. I mean, there is a very serious gang problem. There was a very, very bad incident, as you know, by Brent Cross Tube Station, and the police and the council are taking it terribly seriously. We had a presentation as councillors to explain to us where the problems exist and what the sort of people who contribute a great deal of the crime are and what the council can do about it. And unfortunately, there are particular groups where a lot of the crimes are concentrated with. There is, to exactly that end, planning permission has been granted and funding has been organised for a new youth facility in a neutral area between gangs, and it's been specially placed to allow that. There is the new charity that's been set up to help people who are in care and who are deprived of many of the resources of those with families that have to start careers. There is the new sports facility at Cocktail. So actually a lot of money is being invested in the borough, in youth activities, because the council recognises deeply the problems that exist.
Well, I would echo those comments. I mean, just to start on a slightly lighter note about younger people engaging with politics, I was privileged on Saturday to be out campaigning with over 100 young people who were all supporting the Labour Party and were out helping us to take the Labour message. And those young people were all deeply and thoroughly engaged in politics, and I think that was really exciting to be part of that. But there are clear problems, and you know the idea of cuts in the youth service, cuts in social care, which have been pushed out through local authorities because of cuts that the national government have brought in. These are incredibly important services that provide a safety net for those people that don't have the access to parental care that many people do. And those things do undermine the fabric of our society. And those, I'm sure, as Jack said, are the core of problems around knife crime and gang crime that is there. There's a multitude of issues, but taking away the fabric of the key fabric of our society is part of that. And clearly things like cuts to libraries, where school kids can't get access to library provision if they're studying GCSEs, they aren't able to use the PIN card if they're under 16. All of these things, I think, have a huge impact in terms of services that we're providing for young people. And the number of children that are living in temporary accommodation is a scandal. 3,000 in Barnet last Christmas, and across the UK the picture is the same. And we need to tackle these things at a national level and at a local level if we are going to support our young people and stop them getting into a gang culture and following a life of crime.
Thank you.
Oh, this other one, other Gemma Ferguson is actually 18 years old. So we have a couple of 18-year-olds in Barnet Greens who are running for the council. So if you want to talk about young people, then they're the people to actually go to. And I'm actually proud of the fact that young people, well, the Green Party is quite popular with under 18, so it would be nice if they could get the vote, because they're the ones actually going to be dealing with climate change, which is actually, we can see, happening right now. And another way, that's the reason why that we would prefer renovating council estates rather than actually demolishing them and then rebuilding them to profit property developers. As for youth services, I would actually agree with that. It doesn't even actually have to be that expensive. You just need to have a space. I'm sure there's a lot of spaces available for Barnet Council that they have actually access to, that have actually been boarded up. If you could actually give that facility to teachers. I mean, in my area, New Barnet, there's a warehouse that actually teaches boxing. In Finchley Central, there's a guy who teaches martial arts. Cross between Chinese and Japanese martial arts. Sorry, that's my prime interest. I'm sure there's some football clubs around the area, and it doesn't really even have to cost that much money. It's just if you can actually just find the teachers who actually are willing to take these up, and it's great. They'll be able to actually achieve something and get people to get off the streets, because idle hands make devil's work. As for the libraries, yes, I have been involved with Fine Barnet Library, where we try to save it from the cuts. Unfortunately, now all the libraries are bought and nearly done. Sorry. Anyway, libraries would actually be good for young people, but then watch out for either Labour or Conservative who actually do cut them a lot.
Before I take the next question, the lady I'm going to take it from.
I've tried several times. No one can mention
the
community, please.
I was going to just bring that you come in. I was going to talk about the youth services that in Child Zeal, unfortunately, there's not a great deal for our teenage residents, and this I've seen firsthand, and it would be good to know that all the parties concerned do take that into account. I don't think it requires a great deal of money. I just think it needs joined up thinking. But of course, that's just a personal view. If I can just, the lady over there.